Здравствуйте.
Whether you aim to win your next CDF competition, or just find a Chrome Zero Day, or just to be cool, binary exploitation is a must. It is less known, but it's a more important piece of cybersecurity. Anyhow, in this video, I will guide you through binary exploitation so you can finally be cool at parties. Well, this last part is a lie. Buffer overflow or stack overflow vulnerabilities simply consist of overflowing the stack by somehow filling it with more data than it is supposed to in a way by which other important values will be overridden. Such flaws manifest when a program does not check for the size of some input which is controlled by the user. They are dangerous as they can be used to redirect code execution and in most cases execute what is known as a shellcode. Though know that it is possible to exploit it without using so, but we'll explore that later. A shellcode is simply a set of assembly instructions which a malicious party would input and direct the execution to do pretty much anything he wants. Before I show the hows of buffer overflows, there are some considerations to establish. Modern binaries have a couple of protections against binary exploitation. We will see later that they aren't anything crazy, but they are still present. In the case of buffer overflows, the primary one is the stack cookie or canary. It's just a random value placed on the stack right before the return address, which is checked. If it gets overridden, the program will cease execution. Now, this is bad for us, as the return address is what we want to override in order to redirect the code's execution. Another thing that would get in our way is ASLR, or Address Space Layout Randomization, which randomizes the base address of the modules in the memory. But you might not understand yet what this all means, so I'll just cut to the chase. For now, I will be using binaries which have those security features disabled. Let's go to the meat and potatoes. Here I have a simple program which calls the function start level. In this function is a buffer of 64 bytes and a call to gets. You can ignore the void pointer as it is not the return address from the stack itself. Gets is an unsafe input function which does not check for the size of a user's input, so we're in business. Let's use inline Python to generate 80 uppercase A's. The buffer is of 64 bytes, so it should override some important values and cause the program to crash. It indeed does. Now what we'll want to do is find the right padding to the return address. If we simply disassemble the program, we can check how much space it makes. When call is executed, the return address should be pushed and the base pointer, which points at the base of the stack. And then we can see it subtracts 0x50 from the stack, which in decimal is 80 bytes. If we subtract 64 from 80, which is the size of the buffer, we get 16. So at least 16 extra bytes should be written in order to reach the base pointer and return address. So, from all this information, we can deduce that the padding should be of 88 bytes, as 64 bytes are for the buffer, and 16 are for some values. And another 8 is for the base pointer. So now, anything we will add past the padding should override the return address. To test all this, I will generate a Python script, or write a Python script, which will generate our payload. In it, I will first fill a variable named padding with 88 A's. Then I will make one named target and will provide it the bytes for the address of the function complete level. In order to get its address, we'll run the following command and pipe its result to grep to filter for the function complete level. Object dump is a useful program which can be used to get various symbols and information from binaries. The dash T option simply specifies to display the symbols of the input. Here we have the address. Now, in order to properly format it so we correctly jump, we can make use of the Python lib struct. It's a library which can, as its name implies, convert Python values to binary equivalent. We will invoke the function pack from it and provide it a filter for how to pack the address, this one, and the address itself, of course. The first character of the filter specifies lil endian, and the second, which is q, will specify the type long long, which is basically 8 bytes of size. At the very end of the script, we'll print padding plus target. Now all we have to do is run the script and pipe its result to the program we target. And success. Alright, we overwrote the return address, but where is the shellcode? Well, what we'll have to do next is make one and jump in it. We'll be using assembly and make a syscall to execv, which is a syscall that we can use to execute instructions from a string, well, a program. And by passing a string containing the path of a shell like bash or sh, we'll be able to pop one. The assembly code you're viewing will make a syscall to execv. In 64-bit, syscall does not require pushing values on the stack. It instead requires us to use registers in a certain order. execv takes a total of 3 arguments, the first one being the path of the program to execute, which will be stored in the register RDI. The second and the third will be useless to us, but they're stored in RSI and RDX, and are respectively used to pass execution arguments and environment variables, pretty much exactly like you would when you execute a program in the command line. The code first moves the value X3B, which is 59 in decimal, inside of RAX, as RAX is used to define which syscall to utilize using its number. Then, for now, move 0 into RDI, as we don't yet have the address of the string we'll use to execute a shell. Then it performs a simple XOR gate on both RSI and RDX on themselves, which will set their values to 0, as two identical inputs in a XOR gate will return 0. And the reason for not using a MOV instruction instead is just a question of size. The MOV instructions requires more bytes, so it will make our shellcode bigger for no reason. To find this string, which will contain the path of a shell, we'll drop stack 4 inside of GDB, then start and break on entry by typing start I. Now if we do info proc map, we can get the start and end address of all loaded modules. We can see that there seemingly are two memory spaces used by libc, the second one probably being data. We search through the source of libc, we can find a static global defined variable which contains as a string the path of sh. Now this is probably not the same version as the one used by the program, nor will it have the exact string, but it indicates that chances are that we'll find what we're looking for in it. So to prove our theory, we'll perform a find on the start and end address of this presumably data section, and pass the string slash bin slash sh. We indeed get an address, and when we do x slash s, this address, it prints slash bin slash sh. Now all we gotta do is move this value inside of RDI in our shellcode. Now we'll build the code by running this nasm command. By using object dump, we can extract the individual bytes of the code and then format them as so, and put them inside of a shellcode variable in our Python exploit script. We'll also tweak the padding a bit so that it adjusts to the size of the shellcode. Now, the only step left is to change the value we override the return pointer with to be the one on the stack so we can execute our shellcode. There's only one problem with it. The address of the stack we'll get when we run the program with GDB will be different from the one it has when we run it without GDB, as GDB does some things with the memory layout. The solution we could reuse is simply add what is known as a knob slide. This will make it so that the shellcode will be placed so far in our payload that the address difference between the actual and the one in GDB will be so small that it will still end up executing through the nope, which are instructions which do nothing, and end up running the execv. Now the problem here is that the buffer is only of 64 bytes, and we can only use up to 88 before overwriting the return address. I can think of some solutions, but the best one in this context for this video will be to either use a challenge with a bigger buffer, or simply attach GDB to the program while it runs instead of starting it with it. I'll go for the second, as it will save us some time. So by adding the end option, it will run it in background. But when we do, we're still attached to it. To detach, press Ctrl D. Now, the PID of the program was returned before, so we can attach to it by using GDB by typing sudo gdb-p and the PID. We'll disassemble and put a breakpoint after gets inside of start level. Then continue the execution and type some things. Once the program breaks, we can grab the address of the stack pointer and use it to override the return address in our script. Now, if we finally run the script and pipe its output to the stack 4, we get nothing. To check if the shellcode even works, let's do the same thing but run stack 4 using the strace this time. Well, we can see that exec v indeed gets correctly executed, but the shell exits. The reason for that is simply that it requires some input stream, and because it has none, it simply terminates. In order to fix that, we can use a weird trick I learned from a live overflow. When you run cat, it opens a continuous stream. So by executing the Python script and running cat and then piping the whole thing into stack 4, we can successfully get a shell, and we can now type any command. Now I'm sorry to break the mood, but there's something in modern systems that is called data execution prevention, or for short DEP. As you can probably deduce, it stops us from executing code the way we did, as it gives memory pages read, write, and execute properties. If a page does not have execute permissions, you cannot execute code from it. In the case of our exploit, if DEP was enabled, it would not work at all.
Well, there's nothing we can do.
Or is there? Who said we had to return into our own code when there's plenty of code everywhere in the loaded modules? To exploit this, we'll use something called ret2libc, where we simply return to a libc function. The problem here is that, unlike 32-bit systems, in 64-bits, we are mostly required to use registers rather than just pushing values on the stack. So, we'll also need to use something called return-oriented programming, or for short, ROP. The idea of ROP is that there are things called gadgets. Gadgets are single or sets of instructions which are right before a return. And the idea is that in programs or libraries, you can find so many instructions before returns that you could chain return after return by chaining their addresses on the stack to get a Turing-complete system. System, which you can use to execute anything in the executable memory regions, thus bypassing DEP. It works because every time a return is executed, it will look at the next address on the stack and jump to it. In our case, in order to execute what we want using system, we'll need to move the address of bin sh inside RDI, as system uses RDI as a parameter for the command, and then return to system. To do so, we'll simply look for a gadget inside libc which does a pop RDI and then returns. In order to find this gadget, we can use a tool called ROP gadget. We could write our own gadget finder, but the science behind it isn't really complicated or interesting. We'll use the following command: then pipe its output to grep to filter for pop RDI. This may take a while, as it is a Python script, so it's pretty slow, but once we get an output, we'll look for the one with only a return after the pop RDI and copy its offset. Now I'll run stack 4 in the background and attach GDB to it again, and get the base address of libc. By adding it with the offset of the gadget, we can get its absolute address, which we'll take note of. Then we'll get the address of system by typing psystem. Take note of that too. After this, we'll write a new Python script, import struct, and declare padding, which will fill with 88 A's. Then declare and initialize a variable containing the address of the gadget, one with bin sh, and finally one with system. Now we'll first print the padding, then the gadget, then bin sh, and finally system. What will happen is the function will return to the gadget and then execute pop RDI, which will take the value of bin sh and put it into RDI. Then the return instruction will jump to system. If we run the Python script while using our little trick and piping the result to stack 4, we indeed get a shell again. So now, even if we enable DEP on the binary, our exploit would still work. Now, on the topic of memory leak, I will not discuss it in this video as it is already too long. I will go further in the subject in a part 2, but just so you have some basics, the idea is that in order to bypass ASLR, you'd have to figure out ways of reading memory in unexpected ways, and be able from there to bypass things like stack cookies, etc. If you'd like to know more about this, I suggest you learn about format string exploits. While they're obviously not the only way a memory leak can happen, they're very simple and can teach you some techniques and further your knowledge of binary exploitation. I also haven't talked about other types of overflows like integer or heap overflow, nor have I discussed fuzzing or the awesome library that is pound tools, which you should take a look at. So again, I plan to make a part 2, in which I will discuss everything I would have liked to discuss in this video. Thanks to my Patreons for their outstanding support, and until then, take care.